They celebrated their 50th wedding anniversary yesterday. So, we thank God, you know, that for a wonderful example that we have in Volker and Esther. And this morning we thought we're going to ask them one or two questions just to get some of their experience for us that are still walking the road. So if you'll allow me, Esther and Volker, through the different seasons, what kept you going?
So Gideon, when we first got married, my husband put his shoes outside the door. And I thought, what on earth is he doing? Why does he put his shoes outside the door? And he thought that I would clean his shoes just the same as his mommy did at home. And so he, my father, he cleaned his own shoes and our shoes. So he ended up cleaning his own shoes. Did you mind?
No, I had no choice.
But in the different seasons, you know, when you just think about the storms of life, you go through different, but God is so faithful, and he is faithful, and you know what he is? He's a covenant-keeping God. And that has actually been the cornerstone of our lives. And that is that he's been the third strand in the threefold cord that cannot be broken. And so even the matter of covenant eyes, having eyes just for each other. And he's the one that keeps us. He's the glue in our marriage. And we give him the glory. We are just human like everybody else. We go through things. We go through storms. We go through difficulties. But he's the one that keeps us together. And we glorify him for that.
You know, when we were standing in front on our wedding day, we just said to each other, you know, that we want to give our lives to the Lord and we want to grow old together. And the miracle is, we're not old yet. Look at me. We're not old yet. You know, and it's as simple as that. We just had the desire, you know, to be together.
Well, so how did you deal with conflict? Touching on communication.
I must say, we've had our fair share of conflict in our marriage. And I really must say that, you know, everybody is so different. So here, I want to solve the conflict so badly. I see my wife cry, and I want to give her 100 reasons why she shouldn't cry. And I try to intellectually convince her, don't you understand? But it didn't work till I found out I must put my arms around her. Some time to find out that you have a common enemy. So we've agreed to forgive one another wholeheartedly. So
looking back over the 50 years, what treasure can you leave with us?
Okay, the treasure that I can leave with you and for generations to come is a couple that prays together, stays together. So every single day of our lives together, we have prayed together before the day starts, before all the kids go to school and all the other dramas and difficulties. We have prayed together, and we go for walks around Sable, this area, and we pray when we go for a walk. Every morning we are walking and praying, and sometimes in the evening as well. So that's what actually makes all the
difference. Yeah, it didn't happen overnight. You get into a rhythm. You know, and I think over while you're growing, you think you're growing up, but you're growing in different seasons. And in one season, one thing is important, the other season, this thing is important. And I found that in one season, and that must be continuous, doesn't matter whether it's winter or summer. We have to be people of thankfulness. And you know, when I realize I can give thanks to God for the wonderful wife he's given me, all of a sudden my whole perspective changes. I got a new perspective. And that makes life so much more exciting. So, and you know, when you give thanks, all of a sudden you appreciate the other person so much more. And then I had joy in seeing Esther, you know, really developing and growing into her own person in the way, you know, God had made her, that she accelerated becoming Secretary of the Year in Namibia and things like that. And we could enjoy it together.
Yeah, and one thing I can say is that, you know, this whole thing of honoring one another. And I honor my husband as the covering of our home. And so I don't make the final decisions. It's so good not to have to do that. And he makes the final decisions. And it's a joy to submit because he loves me. And that is the key to a happy marriage.
Thank you very much. That's great. Let's give them a hand, yeah. So maybe if I can just call on the elders, if they can just come to the front, we'd like to pray for them. They can just come to the front, please, and here we go.
Wow.
Just want to give them something as well.
Yeah, we, these lilies, to just so that you know, it's from all of you. It's from all of us to them. And especially the lilies, there's two verses that I would like to share. The one is in Hosea 14, verse 5. I will be like the dew to Israel, and he shall grow like the lily, and lengthen his roots like Lebanon. His branches shall spread. His beauty shall be like an olive tree, and his fragrance like Lebanon. And over the years that we've known them, I can really say that, Volker, you have been like dew to Esther. And she's been the lily who's been able to flower and blossom and grow. And both of you have been able to be like branches spread out with a beauty like an olive tree and the fragrance like Lebanon. And the other verse is in Psalm 133, where it says, where there's unity, God commands a blessing. And it drips from Aaron's beard over to his garment. And this morning, all of us, I'm also emotional almost about it, because all of us can stand under the dripping of the oil that's flowing from your unity and the heritage that you're giving all of us as your spiritual children, of standing here celebrating 50 years of honoring, of loving, of respecting, of caring. So thank you for giving us such a treasure. And yeah, it's inheritance for us and our children and everybody sitting here, everybody being part of your lives. We love you and we appreciate you.
Yeah, so if you can just stretch out your hands, we'd like just to lay hands on them, pray for them.
I want to pray Psalm 20 over your life. May the Lord answer you when you are in distress. May the name of the God of Jacob protect you. May he send you help from the sanctuary and grant you support from Zion. May he remember all your sacrifices and accept your burnt offering. May he give you the desire of your heart and make all your plans succeed. May we shout for joy over your victory and lift up our banners in the name of our God. May the Lord grant all your requests. Father, I pray Volker and Esther's mouth for the Father, it will affect us and change our lives. And us. Father, this is an example for all of us, for generations to come, an example to follow. Father, we thank you. Keep them safe. Keep their families safe. Keep the church safe. In Jesus' name, amen.
Era, Samuel. And back in those days, when a new king came to power, the previous king's descendants were all killed. They were slaughtered. So, as we read through 2 Samuel, we read about David and Jonathan and the wonderful friendship they had. And they actually had a covenant relationship. They made a covenant with one another and said, look, Jonathan actually knew David was going to become king. So he said, look, please, we're good friends here. We love one another as brothers. Let's not. If you become king, please look after my family, my descendants. And the story goes, as we read, Saul and Jonathan eventually were killed in a battle with the Philistines. And as the news reached Israel, fear came upon the people. And Jonathan had a son, Mephibosheth, 5 years old. The nurse grabs him, she wants to flee, and in the whole process, she drops Mephibosheth. And he gets seriously injured, lame in both feet. He got paralyzed in a way. And then we read on. As the years passed, what happens? David becomes king. He's all over Israel's territory, enlarges. David's won the hearts of the people. It's going well with Israel economically, politically. There's a chicken in every pot. There's grapes on every vine. David is prospering. It's going well. What happens? And the theme of my message this morning is a question asked. A question asked. So in this prosperity of David, I can imagine him one day sitting there with a grateful heart and just thinking, wow, how God has blessed me. How God has blessed me. Look at this. Look at where I came from. Look at where I'm now. I'm so blessed. And in a nostalgic moment, he must have, or he might have thought back to his friendship with Jonathan. And he was reminded about the covenant that he and David made with one another, or each other. And this is the question that David asked. And we see that, we find that in 2 Samuel 9, verse 1. Now David said, is there still anyone who is left in the house of Saul, that I may show him kindness for Jonathan's sake? Let me just quickly read through here. And there was a servant of the house of Saul whose name was Ziba. So when they had called him to David, the king said to him, "Are you Ziba?" He said, "At your service." Then the king said, "Is there not still someone of the house of Saul to whom I may show the kindness of God?" And Ziba said to the king, "There is still a son of Jonathan who is lame in his feet." So the king said to him, "Where is he?" And Ziba said to the king, "Indeed, he is in the house of Machir, the son of Amiel, in Lo Debar." Now when Mephibosheth, the son of Jonathan, the son of Saul, had come to David, he fell on his face and prostrated himself. Now you can imagine, Mephibosheth, he had kept a low profile, you know, since his father and his grandfather was killed, because of the fact that all other kings would just slaughter the descendants of the previous king. So Mephibosheth's main aim was to really keep a low profile. And out of the blue, David says, "Go, fetch him." So you can imagine Mephibosheth's fear. He was trembling. He was expecting a spear in the stomach or something like that. But listen to David's words. Then David said, "Mephibosheth," and he answered, "Here is your servant." So David said to him, "Do not fear, for I will surely show you kindness for Jonathan your father's sake, and will restore to you all the land of Saul your grandfather. And listen to this, and you shall eat bread at my table continually." Then he bowed himself and said, "What is your servant that you should look upon such a dead dog as I?" And the king called to Ziba, Saul's servant, and said to him, "I've given to your master's son all that belonged to Saul and to all his house. You therefore and your sons and your servants shall work the land for him, and you shall bring in the harvest that your master's son may have food to eat. But Mephibosheth, your master's son, shall eat bread at my table always." Now Ziba had 15 sons and 20 servants. Then Ziba said to the king, "According to all that my lord the king has commanded his servant, so will your servant do. As for Mephibosheth," said the king, "he shall eat at my table like one of the king's sons." Mephibosheth had a young son whose name was Micah, and all who dwelt in the house of Ziba were servants of Mephibosheth. So Mephibosheth dwelt in Jerusalem, for he ate continually at the king's table, and he was lame in both his feet. A question asked, "Is there yet anyone left in the house of Saul that I may show kindness for Jonathan's sake?" A question of grace asked by a grateful man. Interesting, as Ziba enters, David asked the question. Ziba says, "Yes, there is still a son of Saul, Mephibosheth. He's lame in both his feet." He could have just said, "There's Mephibosheth." But he said he's lame in both his feet. So in a way, he says, yeah, Mephibosheth is crippled. He won't fit in. He's not like the rest of us. He won't be of any use to you. He can't fight in your army. What was David's response? It's interesting that David didn't say, "Okay, he's crippled. How bad is it? How?" No, David said, "Bring him. Bring him in. Bring him in. There's no condition. Bring him in." David wanted to show kindness, and not because of Mephibosheth. They probably didn't even know each other, because he was 5 years old when he fell, became lame, and they fled. But to show kindness for the sake of his father Jonathan, David restored everything to Mephibosheth that belonged to Saul. Ziba must have shaken his head in disbelief. Here's a man who is unknown. He's unknown. He's living in a place called Lo-Debar. It's in the wilderness. It means barren. There's nothing going on there. He's hiding away, keeping a low profile. He's unknown. No consequence. He's of no consequence to the king. He's crippled in both his feet. He can give nothing, nothing, zero benefit to the king and to the kingdom as far as physical strength is concerned. There is absolutely zero personal appeal. But David stoops down in grace. He says, bring him in. On four separate occasions, or four separate times in this, imagine a typical scene a few years later. It's evening, the dinner bell rings in the palace. Ding-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling. Here comes David, sits down at the head of the table. Amnon, clever, crafty Amnon, comes, sit next to his father. Lovely and gracious Tamar, beautiful girl, lovely girl, young woman arrives, and she sits beside Amnon. Across the hallway, Solomon walks slowly from his study. Brilliant, preoccupied Solomon, and he sits down at the table. Then Absalom, with beautiful flowing hair like raven, comes and he sits down. That particular evening, Joab, the king's commander of the army, is also invited for dinner. Comes, sits down next to the king, bronzed, muscular Joab. Afterwards, they wait. Then they hear the shuffling of feet. The clump, clump, clump of the crutches. As quietly finds his place at the table and slips into his seat. And the tablecloth covers his feet. What an amazing example of grace. Do you think Mephibosheth understood grace? In all of this, David was a type of our Lord, who redeems, restores, and returns us to our Father's table in peace. What a wonderful example of grace. Undeserved. Undeserved. When Mephibosheth sat at the king's table, he was treated as one of the king's sons. No less than Absalom or Solomon. And when we feast one day with our Lord, the same will be true. There we shall sit alongside Paul and Peter and David, John, Barnabas, Luke, martyrs, monks, doctors, professors, reformers, missionaries, authors, statesmen alike, with no emphasis on rank or title. Why? Because we are all of us are so undeserving. Disabled all. And oh, how we'll sing God's praise. how we'll sing God's praise. His name is Jesus. All our praise will go to the one who came and died and rose and lives. His name is Jesus. His message is grace. David came, he gave Mephibosheth new life. New life. Jesus came to give us new life. God is still asking the question. He's still asking the question. Is there still anyone who is left that I must show him my kindness for my son's sake? And is there somebody, maybe you can ask the question, is there somebody I can show kindness? Because Jesus has shown kindness to me. The Lord has shown kindness to me. Amen. I'd like to ask Karen, it's okay, Karen, let's just end off with that beautiful song, Amazing Grace. And let's just meditate and think on the wonderful grace that God has bestowed on us through His Son, Jesus.
This message was not meant for your head. It was meant for your heart. Listen to your heart. Don't miss this opportunity. There is grace for each and every one of us. Just make the decision in your heart. God has got mercy for me. I will leave that place where I am, and I will go to the King. I shall not fear. I know He will treat me just like Jonathan's son. Thank you, Jesus, for an open door. for every open heart that responds to you, Lord. We cannot do it. We so often think that we have the power. Forgive us, Lord. You're the only one who can save a soul. We cannot. But Lord, we can proclaim the good news. And may you be glorified today by each and every one who responds to your loving kindness, Father. In Jesus' name, amen.